All right. Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm joined with by Detective Inspector Gretchen Atkins of the Eastern Suburbs Police Area Command, and I want to provide you all with details of a significant breakthrough in the investigation into the disappearance of Melissa Caddick, but we'll recap a few points if you'll bear with me. As you're all aware, Melissa was last seen physically at her home address in Dover Heights on Wednesday, the 11th of November last year. During that day, a search warrant was executed by the Australian Securities Investment Commission, or ASIC, which concluded that evening. Police have been informed that around 5:30 a.m. the following day, the front door of her home was heard to close by her son, who believed that it was Melissa leaving to go for a run. At that time, Melissa left her personal belongings, which included her mobile phone, wallet and keys. The next morning, Melissa Caddick was reported missing to police. As a result, a missing person investigation was launched, which involved police from the Eastern Suburbs Police Area Command, the State Crime Command Missing Persons Registry, and other resources. Appeals for information yielded numerous inquiries, which have been followed up without any confirmed sightings of Melissa from the time of her reported disappearance. Part of those investigations included extensive land, air and sea searches. During the course of those searches, our Marine Area Command provided advice to investigators based on offshore drift modelling that raised the possibility that an object or a body that entered the water around the Dover Heights area could drift as far south as the Bermagui area. I can now inform you that last Sunday the 21st of February, a shoe was located on the shoreline of the Bordana National Park south of Tathra by campers. Within that shoe were the remains of a human foot. That foot and the shoe, which matched the size and description of a shoe that Melissa Caddick was seen wearing during the execution of the ASIC search warrant, were conveyed to the New South Wales Health Forensic and Science Services section here in Sydney, where DNA from the foot was last night matched to a DNA sample from Melissa Caddick's toothbrush and from family members. Melissa's family were informed of the identification last night and are obviously distressed. Now, as you're aware, there's been a lot of commentary and a lot of speculation in relation to the disappearance of Melissa Caddick, and that's understandable. Clearly, the circumstances of Melissa's disappearance have been distressing for many people, including her alleged victims and, of course, her family and friends. I can say that exactly how Melissa came to enter the water is still a mystery and will be subject of ongoing investigations by the Strike Force team. And police have always kept an open mind in relation to what the circumstances were for her disappearance, including the fact that Melissa may have taken her own life. However, a definitive decision in relation to the manner, time and cause of death is a matter for the coroner. And investigations, as I said, will be ongoing. Finally, can I acknowledge the outstanding work of police from the Eastern Suburbs Police Area Command, State Crime Command, our search specialist search officers, the Marine Area Command, and most importantly, our colleagues at New South Wales Health for the outstanding work that they've done in a timely manner to match those remains to Melissa's DNA. I'm happy to take questions now. It was decomposed in a way, so obviously it had been in the water for some time, but luckily scientists were able to extract DNA from that foot and match it to a sample of DNA that we had already obtained from a toothbrush belonging to Melissa and also from her relatives.
Do you suspect that she died shortly after she disappeared?
Look, we just don't know at this point. As I said...
I'm sorry. Has any CCTV footage emerged between the house above the house and
I'll answer that one first, Simon, and I'll come back to you. So look, we just don't know at the moment. It remains a mystery as to when and how she came into the water. And again, that'll be subject of ongoing investigations. In relation to the CCTV, I can say that there was extensive CCTV that's been gathered by investigators, but it does not cover the entire area from where she disappeared.
And Mick, were there any reported sightings of her in the South Coast?
No. We've conducted extensive investigations from the day that she was reported missing to police, and again, we have got a lot of information, but not one confirmed sighting of her. It was campers down a camping down south of Tarthur on the beach. So very, very fortuitous. As I said, the Marine Area Command use modelling software looking at drift patterns and coastal patterns. They were able to advise us that an object that went into the water around the Dover Heights area on the 11th, on or about the 11th of November, could likely, or possibly I should say, drift down as far as Bermagui and even south, even further south, which appears to have been the case.
So it was spot on.
Yeah.
Can you rule that out?
Look, at this point, we can't rule out anything. We've kept an open mind all the way along. However, given the circumstances of her disappearance, the fact that she left personal belongings behind, we've always considered the possibility that she may have taken her own life, but that's a matter for the coroner.
You've got to think for her partner and son, obviously, they've been in contact, and
have they been looked after? Yeah, Gretchen spoke to them last night. They're obviously very distressed, and her wider family members are very distressed as well. We're able to provide some answers, I guess, to them at this point, but, you know, this will continue to be an extensive investigation. It'll take some time to prepare a brief for the coroner, and the coroner ultimately is the person who can provide those answers to family and friends.
Just how decomposed was the body? I mean, when do you think she potentially ended up in the water?
Well, we just don't know. We were left with a shoe and the remains of a foot, and it was quite decomposed.
Why did the police sound so confident she was alive?
Comment. Absolutely. Look, we'll be conducting searches, you know, around the area where the foot was located, of course, now that we know the identification of it, of who it comes from. The searches and an ongoing investigation will take all forms as we normally would. And again, you know, we need to provide as many answers as we can to family and friends. And of course, everyone else that's been affected by the alleged actions of Melissa.
This is not case closed, is it?
No, not at all. Absolutely not at all. You know, there will be extensive investigations that will be ongoing. ASIC obviously have their proceedings, which are currently underway, and they're a matter for ASIC. And we have been working with ASIC all along in relation to this. But, you know, this matter will form a coronial brief of evidence, and the coroner ultimately will determine what's happened. We're in the process of speaking to those investors as we speak as part of the investigation. So, look, we'll have to work with ASIC and see, you know, where those inquiries take us. But ultimately, at the moment, given the fact that we've been able to identify Melissa, it'll be a matter for the coroner that we'll focus on. Well, the last description we have is from the video that was taken during the search warrant executed by ASIC on the 11th of November last year. It's ironic that part of that search warrant footage included footage of her feet and the shoe that she was wearing. And as I said, the shoe that was found down at down south of Tarthra on the beach there was the same type and size. So obviously, you know, we were hanging and waiting for the results of DNA comparisons.
Were the campers aware of the Melissa Caddick?
Oh, look, I don't know, to be perfectly honest, but I'm sure they are now.
Were Melissa's family informed when the shoe was found, or did you wait because you wanted to be sure?
No, we waited till we wanted to be sure. You know, at the end of the day, there's a lot of commentary, as you guys are all aware, in relation to this matter, and a lot of speculation about it, and we didn't want to jump to conclusions without confirming.
But police sounded quite confident. She was alive, the commissioner was on radio speaking
about
an entertaining possibility.
Well, you know, with any missing persons case, while ever there is hope and then families have hope, we have hope too. We owe it to people's families, we owe it to victims to appeal for information, and to, if people are out there that are missing, we want them to come forward. So that's a normal course of any missing persons investigation. But we do ensure that we keep an open mind and we consider all possibilities.
Were there any serious leads she was alive?
The fraud investigation, obviously normally you'd be pursuing that with a view to a criminal charges against someone.
Yep.
That's obviously not possible now against Ms. Caddick.
Yep.
Have you got any evidence suggesting anyone else could be involved in the fraud?
Oh, look, that's a matter for ASIC, to be perfectly honest, and I don't want to comment about their investigations. I'm not across the detail of what they have. You know, we've been focused on a missing persons investigation from the Eastern Suburbs Police Area Command. So we'll work with ASIC and see what they've got there. But
is your fraud investigation stopping?
No.
Hadn't
begun formally? No. We were working with ASIC, and we're in the process of commencing a fraud investigation alongside of what they were doing. But at this point, obviously, you know, we'll need to work out and see where we go from there.
Could you please tell us as well about what police are investigating in terms of potentially her last movements? What are you looking at as how she may have gotten to the South Coast?
Well, obviously, you know, we're looking at what the things that I've already said, the drift patterns and the tidal patterns that may have taken her body from the location where she disappeared or any other location down to where the foot was located. So that's obviously a huge focus.
Do you believe that she got there on foot by car?
We simply don't know. Oh, it's one of the most high-profile missing persons cases that in the 30 years that I've been in the police force that I've seen, for good reason. You know, there are understandably people out there who are very distressed about her alleged actions, and the circumstances where she disappeared have been intriguing, and it remains a mystery at this point in terms of how she actually became in the water. Sorry, Clint.
Can you just describe exactly whereabouts the body was found?
No, a remote beach location south of Tarthra. I don't have the name of the beach, but we'll give that to you. So. We don't know, and that's all we know is that our modelling from our Marine Area Command indicates that an object that would have gone in at that time could possibly have drifted as far south as Bermagui, and here we go. You know, her foot has been found literally 25 kilometres south. East of Bega, in that exact location.
And we'll leave that press conference there, but yeah, that is quite extraordinary developments, aren't they? I mean, that is some 500 kilometres away from where they think she went missing some time ago now. So those developments are very significant for the police force, and also the investigation is now ongoing and still huge amounts of mystery surrounding
right.
exactly what happened to her.
Yeah, they're looking at several lines of inquiry, including that she took her own life, but some very grim and distressing details there for her family this morning. There'll be more coverage shortly.